we brought our subject matter expert, Anne Connelly, in with us today, who's the person who's actually been the one scheming and building out this whole series of events, helping us figure out how does civil society interact with decentralized technologies. I bet there is not a question you can come up that'll stump Anne, but I dare you to try.
Thanks, Eli. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Anne Connelly. I spent 10 years in the nonprofit sector working mostly for Doctors Without Borders and other medical humanitarian organizations. So I worked in the field as well as in the fundraising department. So I come from your world. And then I've spent about 10 years working in the cryptocurrency and blockchain space, mostly looking at applications for social impact and global development. And so I can answer all your questions about the basics of blockchain and crypto, what it is, how nonprofits can use it. I actually wrote a great book on, it's called Blockchain, what's it called? Bitcoin and the Future of Fundraising, which is an easy guide, a 101 guide for nonprofit professionals to learn what is all this cryptocurrency, how can you use it to fundraise for more money. So I'd recommend taking a look at that one. But yeah, as Eli mentioned today, open Q&A. So if you have any questions about stuff we've talked about in the previous sessions or things that you're just like not clear on with blockchain, or if you want to tell me about your organization and I could talk to you about some of the different ways that you could actually use blockchain and cryptocurrencies to help create more impact. So definitely no question is too simple. So feel free to put your hand up, drop questions in the chat. And I'm keen to learn more about what you guys are working on and how we might be able to help. Curious, you know, wants to learn a little bit more. John, you've got your hand up. Do you want to go ahead?
Sure. Thank you very much for being here. And I agree, your book's really great. And
thank you.
And golly, there's so much to learn. And you guys are doing a great job of what you're doing here. And I personally really appreciate it. We recently applied for a Gitcoin grant in that cycle, and we're learning the ropes a little bit. And so we found out there's one step that we didn't perform. There was two steps to the process and one step we didn't perform. That's fine. There'll be another bus coming along, hopefully in first quarter of next year for Gitcoin. And so we've put together a funding project that we're going to reapply next year to get Bitcoin with. And so you had mentioned that you were a review person on some of these projects. And from what I know, that these projects will often be open source software solutions, maybe D-Web apps and things like that, or they may be just common good community type projects. And we fall into the latter category. And so we just want to build awareness of our mission and our organization in the Web 3.0 community. Making a long story short, we were just wondering, since you've been played that role in the community, if you could comment on some of the general guidelines or how a reviewer would approach a project like that. And I realize too, it's just not you doing the reviewing, it's also the community and crowdfunding doing the reviewing, and Quadratic, which I'll let you explain further,
sure,
funding model. And so I'd just be curious for you to comment on that process as a reviewer and what you saw and how that went for you.
Sure. Yeah. So to bring everybody a little bit up to speed, Gitcoin is an organization in the crypto space that their mission is how to support the creation of public goods in the world. So anything that people can access for free or is open source. Now, because it comes from the blockchain space, a lot of the early stuff they were supporting was, again, open source software, public goods type software, but they are growing and expanding. And one of their biggest mechanisms for doing that is through their Gitcoin Grants program, where it's a little bit like Kiva in a way, where anyone can post a project that they're working on that is a public good of some kind. And then anyone in the community can donate to any of these different projects, which is pretty cool. So they run a round about every quarter where they get money from blockchain corporations that will match the funds donated by the community to these different projects. So John and his organization have been doing some great stuff to get their project up on that website and get access to some of its grant money. Now, I actually don't review the projects. I'm more in a governance role with Gitcoin. But I can say, I think the biggest piece is keeping in mind who the donor audience is. So with the people actually making donations on the platform, most of them are, everyone holds crypto. So most of them come from the crypto community and are part of that crypto philosophy. And so really getting to understand what that community is like and how they're different from a traditional audience is really important. And part of that is, what are the causes that they really care about? And some of those things might be related to privacy or access to software or decentralized applications, like something, usually more techie things might appeal to that audience, but you never know. It again comes down to personal desires in terms of people's philanthropy, but just figuring out a way to communicate with that audience to ensure that your project is connecting with them is really key. Now, in my book, there is a whole chapter on what the community looks like, but traditionally in fundraising, you may have your average donor is a female who's between 50 and 60. In the crypto community, the average crypto owner is between like 24 and 30, and they're male, usually white. And so the profile of the donor is actually quite different. So I would say if you're posting a project up on this Gitcoin Grants platform to get people to donate to you, then keep in mind that the people that you're writing for and the people you're trying to connect with are not the donor you're used to communicating with. So that they're much more, tech savvy, male, white, kind of North American, European type cultures on that platform in particular. The other thing that's cool and I would check out is that Gitcoin just yesterday announced that the American Cancer Society is now actually going to run an entire grants program by themselves using the software that Gitcoin has put together. So they'll have a whole platform where they can post all sorts of different projects that the American Cancer Society is working on, and you can fund those specific projects through the platform with your cryptocurrency, which is pretty neat. We can drop a link to maybe the tweet that announced that into the chat so you can take a peek, but I would definitely have a look at that one. And yeah, I think just check out Gitcoin in general, because I think they're doing some pretty boundary pushing work in the philanthropy space that most people in traditional philanthropy will not be exposed to, because they just won't necessarily see it because it's coming from blockchain and crypto, but they're doing some really neat stuff. So one of the things that John mentioned was this idea of quadratic fundraising. And the premise there is, if you imagine if a city had two projects, like a flagpole and a community garden, and they said to the citizen, we'll match dollar for dollar whichever project you donate to, which is a standard way to do matching funds in the giving world. And so if 100 people give a dollar each to the community garden and one rich person gives $100 to the flagpole, each of those projects gets $100 in matching funds, even though 100 people really want one of them and only one person wants the other. And so the idea behind quadratic funding is you only get matched for the square root of your donation. So for example, if I give $100, the square root of 100 is 10. So I would donate 100, but only $10 of that would get matched. Whereas if I gave a dollar, the square root of 1 is 1. So my dollar would get matched 1 for 1. So the whole premise behind that matching structure is moving matching funds away from projects that have a small number of rich donors and moving it towards projects that have a large number of maybe less fortunate donors or smaller donors. This is a piece of supporting the community or community-led and supported projects, as opposed to ones that just have a small amount of support. So they're doing some really cool stuff around that. And that mechanism is being used in their Gitcoin Grants platform, which is cool. So I would check that out. And if you're nerdy and keen, you can check out Kevin Owaki on Twitter. He's the founder of that organization. But the organization actually now runs, it's a completely decentralized organization. So every community member that's a part of Gitcoin gets a vote on where the organization is going and what their focus is, which is also pretty cool. All right. Thanks, John. That was great. Do we have any other questions? We've got 31 people in this chat, which is awesome. I'm keen to just hear what some people are working on as well. And then maybe we can chat through how they might be able to incorporate blockchain into what they're doing. We've got Jeff from Meadowview. I don't know, Jeff, do you want to tell us a little bit more about your organization? Not, Jeff is more of a listener today. That's okay. Who else do we have? Anyone keen to just talk about what they're doing?
I'm interested in hearing ideas, if you're willing.
Yeah, absolutely. Please go ahead.
Okay, so we are an arts festival that runs every July, just a month. And as arts festivals, we're funded by various entities or whatever, but I'm interested in getting our organization digitizing some of their arts things. We have collectible things that every year has a new theme. And so I'm trying to get into the space where our artists can also be helped by utilizing this technology. And I'm not sure where to start, what blockchain to use, what platform, how to bridge that gap, because our donor profile is the community. So it's much younger people who don't really leverage that. So would they do it through a third party like PayPal or something, or Venmo, or is that even possible? I'm not sure.
Yeah. So one of the obvious pieces for you guys, it's certainly going to be around NFTs or non-fungible tokens. And essentially it's just a token that represents something unique. For example, if I had one Bitcoin or a different Bitcoin, that doesn't really matter. They're both the same. But if I have a token that represents my cell phone or a token that represents my coffee mug, those two things are distinct. And so you can't trade one of those tokens for another. In popular culture, the main use for NFTs so far is digital art pieces. And so you have a digital art piece that's then linked to a token on blockchain. And because it's linked to that token, you can identify which of the many copies of this art digital art piece is unique and is the original one, which enables you to have and hold this special piece of art, but then be able to sell it onward if you wanted to. And so that's something that would really appeal to younger crowds. Most people in the kind of younger age groups have some access or some have they've worked with NFTs or looked at NFTs or heard of NFTs before. And it's a great way to either do additional revenue and additional sale for each artist. So if they just took their art, made a digital version, and then sold those pieces as well. Or you can also use them as a stewardship mechanism, so like a digital badge. So one of the cool things that is being done with some of the conferences and stuff are like, if you sign in with your wallet, you'll get an NFT that kind of proves that you were there at that event in that year. So you can make cool little badges like that. You could even do a bit of a hunt where each artist might have a badge that you get when you scan at their different desk or their gallery or whatever it is. So there's different ways to gamify the participation, but then also using them as like potential revenue mechanisms for the artists themselves. So I would definitely check that out.
I've checked that out like at CES and participated, but what I found is down the road, all those links die. So it's interesting. You have all these NFTs and then like they just get rid of the storage or something happens. And so they just end up being dead links. And so I find it, this is not very reliable. If you participate, you engage, it's fun. And then down the road, it's all dead links. Like that's not valuable. So we're thinking of, is there a way that we could store our own and then host it on our own, so we have more control over that, so it just doesn't result in dead links down the road. But yeah, I'm interested in learning more, maybe offline or something. I don't want to take up other people's time.
Yeah, I mean, I would say the most ideal way to store it is in a decentralized fashion, so using IPFS or other decentralized storage mechanisms like Filecoin or Storage. Those are good ways to do it, and then you can ensure that it doesn't go away. So I think it depends on a few things. It depends on what kind of longevity do you need it to have? Is it just for the day of? Do you want it to last forever? And the other things you could do is actually put code into it that it's going to disappear after a certain amount of time. So maybe it's like you get this badge when you donated, but that badge only lasts for a year and then you need to make another donation to get badge back or something like that. So there's different ways to think about it too. But yeah, arts and NFTs definitely go a little bit hand in hand.
So OpenSea or third party or start your own? I'm curious.
I again, I think it would come back to what's the usability you need and what's the function. So OpenSea is great. It's huge. It's the biggest marketplace in the world. So if people want to do onward sale, if I'm buying an art piece that I may want to sell in the future, definitely OpenSea, definitely the Ethereum blockchain. If you're doing badging where it doesn't matter so much, you may want to mint on a cheaper protocol or a cheaper blockchain. You could use Palm Network, Algorand, that sort of thing. And then it doesn't matter if it's more accessible for sales because people aren't really ever going to sell it. POAP is another one I would take a look at. POAP. It's a proof of attendance protocol. And that one's good for more of the badging and attendance type pieces. Yeah.
So take Thank a look you. At those.
No problem. Teodora, go ahead.
Hi, everyone. Hope you can hear me.
Yes.
Perhaps you see a wrong name. I'm Emilian. And Teodora is my wife, but
sorry.
No, it's fine. You can call me Emil. I'm from Bulgaria, and we are running an NGO that is developing the startup ecosystem in the region. And we're also now launching kind of a blockchain association.
Okay.
We would like to do a mapping of blockchain entrepreneurs, investors, builders, and generally the blockchain community. We are one of the pioneers. Me personally, I have been developing blockchain solutions for the last several years. And I have a specific question. And it is about the governance of this community. Can you recommend service or software for voting, for decision-making, maybe DAO, that you have seen working in other NGOs or in other communities? It is mostly about transparent decision-making and also channeling resources, perhaps in some cases, in order to make sure that decisions are taken in a very efficient and secure and transparent way.
Yeah. So most DAOs use a system that drives me crazy. So they'll do the kind of proposal posting and discussion on Discourse, which is a pretty basic forum software. And then they'll do a kind of straw poll vote off chain, and then they'll vote on chain. And one of the votings is snapshot and the other is tally. And I can't remember which one is on chain, which one is off chain, but one is one. One platform that I would really recommend that I like a lot is called Sway, SWAE.io. The reason I like it is the interface is very user-friendly. So it's a little more like the UX UI is better done, and people can post proposals, all the discussion can happen. You can do off-chain voting there. And then you need to decide, do you actually need on-chain voting or not? And if you do, then you'd have to take that vote again to one of the on-chain voting softwares. But I know they were looking at integrating with one of those to get the on-chain voting, but I don't think that's happened yet. But I would take a look at them because I think that's probably the cleanest one that I've seen so far, especially if you're trying to get a broader community involved. But awesome to see that you're putting that together. I would also check out Raid Guild, which is a DAO that supports the construction and infrastructure of other DAOs, and just see if they've got other options that'd be worth taking a look at.
Great. Thank you.
No problem. All right. Let's see. I think in the chat it said next up, Jackie Senkandwa. Jackie, do you want to go ahead?
Oh, yes. I was simply asking, we tried to go to Giving Block to just set up our nonprofit so we can receive by crypto, but it has been a not so clear process. And so I was like, maybe we should try something else. So how do we use Filecoin as well?
The best other options so let me backtrack. You can just set up a wallet for yourself and accept the crypto and then create an exchange account and trade it yourself. That's possible. If you're trying to keep things like really simple and easy, Giving Block is one option. If that's not working for you, I would check out Ukapay, EUKAPAY.com. And I've also heard of Every.com, but I haven't used that one myself. If you want an intro to Ukapay, I'm happy to provide that. And what they do is they just, very similar to Giving Block, they just accept the crypto and then they'll wire you the money or make a bank transfer. And it's super easy. And then your organization doesn't have to ever touch the crypto. So I would check those out. Although I'm surprised Giving Block isn't going well because they've been around a long time and they're one of the mainstays. Their fees are quite high though, but I'm surprised it's not working super well because I feel like that would have been good. But check out the other companies there. And yeah, if anyone knows other ones, definitely drop them in. Next up, we have Ron. Go ahead.
Hey, thanks for having me. Ron Griswold calling from North Carolina. My organization, HBCUs Outside, which I serve as executive director of, we're interested in correcting racial inequities around nature on historical Black colleges and universities. And so our main thing right now is figuring out what it looks like to build true community as opposed to what many people see as community via social, whereas those are platforms where you do not quote unquote own or have direct access. Those are rented communities. And so right now we're looking at a software slash a new company called TYB, which is started by Ty Haney, the original founder of Outdoor Voices. But pretty much through TYB, what you're able to do is token gate experiences, as well as provide incentives. And since we work with college students, providing them incentives and challenging and promoting challenges to get up to get involved are huge areas where we see engagement. This is something that we're extremely interested in, is an owned community, as well as incentivizing students and token gating experiences. So I was really just interested to see what is out there beyond TYB. This is the only one we've heard of that allows, that gives us access to across those three different goals that I just spelled out for.
Yeah, to bring people up to speed, token gating is just you need a token to be able to do something or to join a club or to be a part of whatever. So like having a membership, but it's in a token format. So it just makes it easier to validate some of those things. I haven't heard of TYB before. It sounds pretty cool. I think that for me, the sort of difference between this concept of rented community and true community is where does the power sit? And I think, as you say, these sort of social online, social media communities, they're great for chit chat, but for real change and real change in ownership, that's where the DAO structure really makes sense. So I would take a look at that. I'm not sure what TYB exactly executes, but just to backtrack for everyone's benefit, the idea of a DAO is like to have a community of people that want to achieve a particular goal together. So that goal could be anything. It could be reducing racial inequities. It could be building a software application. It could be coming together to make granting decisions on philanthropic activities. It could be anything. But the difference is that every person who participates has a certain proportion of token. And so some DAOs will organize themselves by one person, one token. Other DAOs will say you get the same amount of tokens as the money that you put in to support the initiative that we're doing. Totally depends. But those tokens give you voting power and you can vote on what's going on with the DAO. And it's essentially just bringing power structures to be much more flat. So in a traditional organization, you'd either have a hierarchy where people at the top have power and they make decisions for the people at the bottom. Or even if you have a flat organization, you'd probably have a board of directors that makes decisions. With a DAO, every person is really making those decisions. And so that's really a key way to shift those power structures. And so I would be curious about whether TYB, in giving these tokenized incentives to students, is actually giving them power over anything. And I think that's really where I'd love to see that shift. Let's say they do an action, they get an A on their thing, and then they can go to visit a park for free or something. Like, that's good, but it's not really any different than a points program in a traditional software app, from my view. I don't think you need blockchain to do that. I think you can do that without it. You can have it and it's fine, and it might add some other things to it. But I would really look at how can you start to actually, say, work with the parks so that any person that gets access to a token then has the ability to vote on what happens to that park, or the students or anyone who has those tokens. Maybe there's funding that they get to then decide on how it's distributed. Because again, I really think, the social media and connecting everyone is one level. This tokenized incentives is another. But what we're really trying to get to is eliminating the racial inequities in power structures. And that's where I think the sort of DAO structure will get you there. I think the question just is, where does the power sit now? What elements do they have control over? Which ones do you want to change? And the structures of those, like the potential of that, is endless. So for example, if I gave you an example, I worked for an organization that was pretty, flat. It was a traditional nonprofit with a pretty hierarchical structure in the office, but it had an association of community members, and they had the right to vote for the board, and the board would then choose the CEO. In a DAO structure, all of the DAOs, the members, instead of maybe voting for a board of director, would actually directly vote on who they wanted to be the CEO, or they would directly vote on, this is the budget, how do we want to spend it? And then they may hire, and they may still have a hierarchical structure that actually executes that, or they may have a totally decentralized structure that does it, where any person can say, hey, I have this proposal for something I want to do. Can I get budget? Everyone votes yes or no, and then it gets executed. So like, the way it can roll out can be very different, but I think the key piece at the end of the day is actually who holds power. I didn't really answer your question in terms of what are the other options besides TYB, but I think the bigger question would be, like, to what extent are you trying to disrupt the models? Is it just, hey, how can we incentivize previously disadvantaged Black students to get out in nature? And maybe TYB achieved that. Maybe that's the end goal, but maybe you actually want more of that representation to, you could even have a collective of the students that get those tokens to collectively hold one board seat on the National Parks board or something like that. So I would think about, yeah, at even one level deeper of how do you get more power? Hopefully that made sense.
Yeah. Thank you so much. You definitely got me thinking about quite a lot. And with the introduction of what you said, DAO, it seems like it's not necessarily, it's completely different than a co-op, of course, but it seems like there's just more engagement from the way you explained it. And we are trying to give that quote unquote power to the students to be, we want to be making informed decisions, not just what we think as older adults. This is what you should be doing. So thank you for that. And something I've been listening to, there's a really great episode, Baratunde Thurston interview. I think his name was something Zhao, but he's the mayor of Friends with Benefits, which is like a DAO community. And I've been really interested in seeing what it looks like to join one of those things. It seems like they're very, while they may do a lot of things online, they utilize those spaces to meet IRL in real life to make that deeper change. I've been really interested in seeing what it feels like to be a part of one of those as well. If there's any other suggestions you have for something like Friends with Benefits, I want to personally join and see what it feels like to be a part of that community as well.
Yeah, there's tons of DAOs. There's a great graphic that I don't know if Eli, you can maybe hunt for while we're chatting, but it's essentially just a big box with a list of 1,000 different DAOs and their logos. I know in particular for women, there's like a social DAO called Meta Gamma Delta for just people who are totally new, want to make connections. There's probably something very similar for people from the Black community who might be wanting to see who are the other Black entrepreneurs in the blockchain space. I know in particular, there's definitely Black blockchain associations, a couple of them, I think, certainly ones that are geographically connected as well. In terms of other DAOs, I would check out Gitcoin, partially because it's quite large, has decent infrastructure. So they have so much money and so many people that they're building out the tools to organize themselves well. So that I would check out. The social DAO can be interesting, but can often fall apart pretty quickly because it still requires people to do volunteer work and organize other people and set all the stuff up. It can sometimes sort of peak and or ebb and flow based on who's involved. But if we could check out that, yeah, list of social DAOs, I would check out those ones. And I think you may find something good. All right. Let's see if we've got any other questions in the chat. Lots of great resources in there. Thanks, Eli. All the DAOs. Yeah, DAOs are pretty cool. I think Ron's analogy to it being like a co-op is very accurate. The key differences I would say are that in a co-op, you still need to trust someone to manage the money. Someone's got to put their signature on the bank account, and doing a co-op that's cross-border would be very difficult. So if you're trying to do something with, let's say, diaspora of Irish people all over the world and trying to connect them, and they all want to, say, pool money together to donate to Irish causes or something like that, getting their money from all these different banks from all over the world would actually be really challenging and expensive. And then the other piece, so doing it in cryptocurrency makes that really easy and really quick. And then the second piece is transparency around voting. If you trust everybody in your co-op and you can all vote in a transparent way and you're not worried about somebody hacking the software or miscounting the votes, then you probably don't really need blockchain. But if you're voting on critical information where it might be important that you're anonymous and it's really critical that the vote and the outcome of that vote is counted in a very transparent way, in a very secure way, then blockchain would be key. So let's say you had, we're going to go deep here. Let's say you needed to have a vote on people's opinion on the Israel-Gaza conflict / invasion. People might not want to have their vote be public or be hackable through the back end of software. And so that's where blockchain could bring that kind of transparency and security to people. In a lot of cases, people are like, I really want to make a DAO. And I'm like, what are the elements of the DAO that you're excited about? Is it just that it's flat and it's a lot of people coming together to work together? You can do that as a co-op sometimes in a lot of cases. But if you're all very international, everyone's got different currencies, maybe you want people to, hold a token so they need to have the token to access the information. You can do some stuff like that. There's some really cool examples of DAOs out there as well. I think one of my favorites that just demonstrate the speed and scale of what you can do with them is exciting. It's called Constitution DAO. And essentially, a group of people found out that a copy of the US Constitution was going up for auction. And they thought it was crazy that one person could just own this document that governs everyone. And so within 48 hours, they brought together 17,000 people who each donated as a part of a group effort to buy that copy of the Constitution. And they raised, I think, $47 million in 48 hours and then bid on the Constitution. Now, unfortunately, they didn't win it because all of those transactions were public. So everyone could see how much money the DAO owned. So someone outbid them, which was very sad. They didn't quite get their Cinderella story. But just the ability to gather that many people in such a short amount of time and pool $47 million into one place was amazing. So that's one I would definitely read about if you get a chance. And I think we have a question from Jackie. So Jackie then, so when you decide to hold the crypto for some time, can Giving Block do that? Is it a DAO? Giving Block is not a DAO. Giving Block is a traditional company. They can hold on to, I don't know if they hold the crypto. I think they will immediately convert it into money. But I haven't looked at their offerings in a little while. If you wanted to hold on to the crypto to maybe take advantage of the price swing and that sort of thing, it would really be, you'd really have to look at it in the same way. And if, let's say somebody donated $100 in crypto, the way to think about it is, would you take $100 from your bank account and invest it in crypto? It's not really, should we leave this in crypto? What's our investment policy with the money that we receive as a donation? I'm all for essentially carving out at least a proportion of what you have and leaving it in cryptocurrency. I think that's important. And maybe that proportion is less than 1%. Maybe that proportion is, hey, as an innovation test or as a trial for something new, we're going to buy $100 worth of Bitcoin and see if it goes up. And mostly for the learning experience of opening a wallet and keeping cryptocurrency and just understanding how to use it. I think that's an important thing and could be a great kind of activity with your organization. And also for yourself, I would say, people say, oh, should I invest in crypto? And I would say, don't invest your money, invest your time. Spend an evening learning about how to open a wallet, how to buy a dollar's worth and no more, and just play around with it. Try to make a donation with it and just see how it works and whether you like that, and just treat it as a learning opportunity as opposed to an investment opportunity. So I would check it out that way. James is saying, I'm trying to find out how to do fundraising by soliciting Web3 decentralized potential donors by finding an individual or group to help. I'm specifically interested in environment, renewable energy, and community solar. Yeah. So if you're fundraising, I guess the key piece, actually, James, are you still here? Do you want to hop on and we can chat?
Sure.
I was doing something for Giving Tuesday, and I was ran across all these solicitation things. And there was some group in England, since they were 8 hours, they like had a time slot open, but they want $3,000. So I'm looking for somebody that can do something that is a lot lower, lower entry point, to put it mildly.
And what do you want them to do?
You can find all kinds of people that'll help you with social media promotion or donation campaigns, but they're talking about traditional social media, Facebook and LinkedIn and stuff like that. I don't know how you reach people that are on the non-traditional platforms I just referred to as Web3/decentralized. I know I'm a member of some Discord groups that are like that, but like I say, I have no idea how to solicit donations from those people.
Yeah. So do you have crypto donation functionality?
Yes, we signed up. There's a group called every.org. They will accept donations and convert them to US dollars.
Yeah, I would check out. And there's a chapter on this in my book too, that just outlines things to not forget. Is number one, is this all over your website? Can people see that they can donate in crypto on the front page or on the donate page, or is it hidden and tucked away? If you want to make sure that people can see it. Secondly, I would check out including that you can donate crypto in your traditional fundraising pieces, your mail pieces, your e-newsletters, because some of these donors might be hiding in your donor file already.
Okay.
I would connect with the meetup groups that are there. So on meetup.com, that's where people will organize like in-person nights to talk about crypto. Usually they're at a pub or a restaurant, very informal, but that's how people will gather. And most of those groups would be super open to you coming down, saying 5 minutes about your organization that you accept crypto. So that's a great way to get started. If you don't necessarily have a geography that you're in, obviously digital is good. I would start promoting on Twitter. Twitter is where most of the crypto conversations happen. So starting to promote that you're accepting donations and tagging the hashtags Bitcoin and Bitcoin Giving Tuesday is another thing that exists. So start tagging that. I guess that was yesterday, but next year. And so that would be spots. But if you're looking for someone go ahead, James. Sorry, I didn't hear you. Can you repeat that? You're not coming through. Eli, is that my side or are you able to hear James?
Unfortunately, James, you're not coming through. I'm going to put you on mute. However, please don't put your question into the chat. We'd love to get that from you.
Yeah. So I would say if you're looking to have someone that can do that and be knowledgeable about where to be posting and how to promote, I don't think you're going to find someone for super cheap, to be really honest. You could search on Fiverr. You could post on your Twitter and just say, hey, we're looking for someone. The challenge is you need someone that is in that community and knows that community, but doesn't have another job that they're doing and would want to be paid to do that. You're boycotting Twitter for political reasons. Listen, I hate Elon. I hate him. I hate him as much as the next guy. But if you're not willing to promote on Twitter, then it's not going to work for you. I'm just going to be really upfront. It's not going to work for you. So I would not put any more effort into a crypto donation program if you're not willing to tweet. That's where the entire community is. It's like saying you're running a charity and you're going to do a mail program, but you're not willing to use the post office because you don't like how they operate. It's just not going to work. So I'll leave that with you. You can decide. They're not hanging out on LinkedIn, right? They're not. So that's up to you. Kaleido. I don't know anything about Kaleido, unfortunately. I haven't heard of them. But I would check Fiverr. I would check, what's the other one that's similar? Upwork. Maybe there's someone that's happy to do a bunch of social media posts and push stuff out about you, but it's going to be on Twitter. That's what I can promise you. Okay. What else do we have here? We have something from Ron is saying Baratunde refers to his involvement as the Constitution DAO. There's How to Citizen is a podcast with Alex Chang and Eli. Oh, that Eli linked above. Apparently it's very good. Yeah, that is a good one. How to Citizen is pretty cool. Okay, let's see. Any other questions from folks? Anyone else want to pitch their organization and we can talk about what they might be able to do?
I have another one.
Go for it, David. Different,
very unique. I'm part of an organization who helps catch criminals, and we've helped solve murders. And the idea is that we host rewards, and a lot of people are scared to come forward because of the dangers of turning in some of these criminals. And I was thinking if we could do something where we could do it through the crypto space. I was thinking NFTs originally, we'd have literally a most wanted poster, and then people could collect a reward that way. But I'm sure there's a better way, because they have to remain anonymous essentially in order to get there. But there might be a technological challenge to, because most of the people who do participate are not tech savvy.
And that's going to be a bit of the challenge. So my question would be, at what point do you need them to be anonymous? Is it the communications point or the payment point?
Yeah, both. So usually what they do is they call into our number and they're given a code that identifies them uniquely.
Okay.
And then from there, depending on the evidence that they give, that's how we identify who they are. And then we usually set up a drop-off point where we literally give them cash. It's interesting.
That is not shady at all. No, I'm just kidding. No, that's great. I would say, so it sounds like you have the communication piece down. I don't think a blockchain is going to provide better solutions for that than what would already be available, that journalists have these sort of anonymous lines and that kind of thing. The payment, for sure, to a point. And this is where, if you're working with not tech savvy individuals, it might get complicated. But essentially, someone could open up a wallet completely anonymously. You can send them crypto completely anonymous. The challenge is, if they want to turn that crypto into cash, they're going to have to figure that out. And so the normal route would be they would connect their wallet to an online exchange, convert the Bitcoin for a local currency, and the exchange would deposit it into their bank account. But in order to use an exchange, they have to go through extensive KYC processes, which is just know your customer or identity verification processes. So that would eliminate the identity piece there. The question is, does that matter? I'm not sure that would necessarily matter, but then the money would hit their bank account anyway from that exchange. And at that point, there would be the question of, where did that money come from? So there's that side of it. The other way is they could just like meet up with somebody who is happy to give them cash for their Bitcoin. There's some Bitcoin ATMs that you can sell your Bitcoin to and get cash. There's not as many out there as ones available for you to buy, so you'd have to look for them. But there's kiosks, definitely, in different cities. Like, a lot of money traders will now buy and sell Bitcoin, that kind of thing, which you'd be doing off book, but totally legally. So that, I would say, on the payment side, for sure. And if you wrote out all the instructions very specifically about, here's how you open it, we're going to send it to you, take it to this place, that they'll turn it into cash, then maybe that's a solution. As at least maybe an option for some people that might be able to handle it, is the other thing. And the other piece is, maybe they don't want to cash it out. Maybe they want to keep it in crypto.
That's cool. I feel like the requirement to report these kind of earnings is really up to the individual, right? As an organization donating the reward, we're not required to report anything.
No, it's not our your problem. No.
Okay, interesting.
The right. Same like the cash. It's up to the person if they're gonna
declare it or not.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. That's cool. I'm like most middle-aged, super true crime junkie. So love that you're solving crimes. There's definitely some initiatives in the crypto space to use crypto for. Or like blockchain. There was one project that was trying to use blockchain to get the backlog of rape cases processed, or rape kits processed. I think the premise was, if you could tie each rape kit to a token on chain that would mark how long it had been sitting unprocessed, and sort of name and shame a little bit the police for not having actually processed the kit. And then you could loop in some sort of system where people could donate the particular kits, maybe the oldest kit, to get the funding to process them. But I don't think it actually ever turned into a real project.
Okay, yeah, because we're trying to do that with playing cards, actually. We have a cold cases, that we've designed playing cards to try to solve cold cases. So I would be interested. What was the name of the project that I tried?
I don't remember, to be honest. I'm not even sure there was like a formal project versus maybe a hackathon idea. Or something like that. Yeah. The playing card pieces for cold cases as a promotion piece is interesting. So one of the things you could do with that, and it's a bit weird because it's cold cases, but let's dabble on this a little bit, is the Gitcoin Grants platform. You could use their platform to post 20 different cold cases and then have people donate funds towards the reward pool for those different cases. I think that would be interesting. I would check out, it's called Grant Stacks, is the one, the part of Gitcoin that you'd be looking for, and you'd run and operate it yourself. Yeah, I would take a peek at that. That could be cool. It is a public good. Solving crimes is a public good.
Yeah, we've been successful in some cases, especially as tech gets better. But I'm sure depending on the amount, we give out $5,000 for each homicide. I think that it might be successful, especially there are some personal cases where people are willing to give $50,000. Family members willing to donate to catch the murderer.
Yeah. That's an interesting piece, because I guess the question would be, are you using the platform to raise funds to solve it, or are you using, if you already have the funds, then you don't really need that. But I guess there's a bunch of cases where you wouldn't have the funds for, right?
We have that challenge. So we have a pool of a good amount of money, but at the same time, we can't hold on to it forever. And so the idea is that the danger is that somebody brings forth a thing and then the donor doesn't give the money. So they have to commit first.
Blockchain can solve that for sure through smart contracts and that sort of thing. And like escrow type pieces. So that could be a good mechanism for that.
Okay. Thank you.
Awesome. James in the chat said, I've had some people concerned about accepting crypto donations from cyber criminals. Every.org claims they do some vetting of donors, but I don't remember the details. So the one thing I would say about that is there's a bit of an over assumption about how much crypto is being used in crime. Can't remember the exact statistic, but it was like less than 1% or something like that is being used in crimes. So I think the piece for me is, what is your policy for every donation? And that should be applied to every donation that you get. So if you get $20 from a check, are you that $20 didn't come from a criminal? You're probably not. So then I'd be curious as to why you would do it for crypto. And then what's your responsibility of the charity to vet that? Maybe you would do it for 10,000 on every donor that would give 10,000, but would you do it on every donor that gave 20? Probably not. So that's really how I would go about looking at it. You're never going to be able to vet every person's dollar back to where it came from. And I think you can get into a slippery slope of donations. I've got one organization I've been talking to that's like concerned about taking money from one donor that he's not the world's most upstanding citizen, but he's not done anything illegal. And we don't know if we should take money from him. I'm like, what's your overall policy? And then I guess, how deep are you going to get into vetting the activities of every donor you take money from? That's my view. I'm noticing that we're actually quite close to the top of the hour now. Maybe we'll take one last question from John, who's got his hands up, and then we'll let you guys get back to your day.
Appreciate it, Annie. I know we have a very short time here, so I'm literally making an elevator pitch here. And our project is called Dare to Prepare, and we want to bring about more education in the area of the blockchain has in the ability to store health information and portability of that information, particularly to populations that are forced to migrate from one part of the globe to the other. And we feel that the centralized Web 2.0 version of things, where everything's in walled gardens and health information is kept in walled gardens, and not even a walled garden, in some cases in a data server at a health clinic or whatever. So we're wanting to really empower individuals to have sovereign over their own health information. And so that travels with them, in essence, with a mobile phone, and they can share that to whoever, whomever they wish to. And so that's what the Dare to Prepare project is all about. Watch for us on Gitcoin the next quarter, first quarter of next year. We'll be offering that project out. So we'd love to have the word spread. Thank you.
That's great. Thanks, John.